everybody. Last one of the conference. It's a pretty big honor to be here and close this out with you guys today. We were so blown away by HubSpot's generosity, you know, that they had said they wanted to, you know, contribute $20,000 and try and unlock that through spreading awareness and encouraging some of you guys to walk, doing the water walk and to tweet. And just sitting around yesterday in New York City with our team for the launch, like, we could not believe what this room was doing to amplify it. So you guys are amazing. Thank you to HubSpot. And it's an honor to be able to close this thing. So today I'm going to talk about charity water. But before that, I'm going to talk a little bit about my story. And I'm going to talk about water and share some of the things that I've learned over the last 7 years since starting this thing. So I'll start with me. This was me at 4 years old. My parents actually used a cereal bowl to cut my hair. Born in Philadelphia, middle-class family. Dad and mom loved each other. They were awesome. He was just a middle-class businessman. Mom was a writer. And one day when I was 4 years old, it was actually New Year's Day, when I was four, this horrible tragedy happened in our family. And we'd moved from the city to New Jersey, and the kind of perfect house. And my mom was excited about fixing up the house. I was excited about spending as little time in the house as possible. And I was out with my friends and playing, and my dad was working long hours. But one day, my mom, on New Year's Day, she passes out and crumples to the floor, and we rush her to the hospital. And after a bunch of tests, the doctors find these massive amounts of carbon monoxide in her blood. And they start to suspect the house. Well, my dad starts ripping things out, eventually finds that the gas furnace that the heating company had installed had these little cracks. And as my mom was fixing up the basement, she was inhaling these fumes. And thankfully didn't die, but almost did. And what did die was her immune system. And my mom, in an instant, went from the most healthy, vibrant person I knew to a complete invalid, allergic to almost everything now in the world. She would wear this charcoal mask. She was connected to oxygen. Anything chemical from that point on made her sick, whether it was ink from a book, whether it was perfume, whether it was soap. And this very bizarre childhood began. She miscarried, family planning stopped, and I really started to come into this role as a caregiver for my mom. Now, some people thought she was crazy. And I remember I even did too once as a kid. She used to tell me that she was allergic to electromagnetic radiation, like the stuff coming from TVs and radios. And I thought she was just trying to stop me from watching TV. So I remember taking a radio once and putting it outside the room that she lived in, which was covered in tinfoil and strange materials. And I just turned the volume all the way down, thinking, well, this is in her head. She's gonna wake up fine in the morning. She woke up incredibly, incredibly ill, having this radio blasting through the door at her all night. And I was convinced as a child that that my mom wasn't faking it and did the best I could to take care of her. So very conservative Christian family. I kind of grew up active in the church. My parents, because of their faith, decided not to sue the gas company and just believed that one day, you know, my mom would get better through prayer. 18 years old, I like so many bad cliches, rebel. I move to New York City, I grow my hair down to my shoulders, I join a band, and unfortunately the band immediately broke up because we all hated each other. So here I am in New York City, but I learned that the guy that was booking out our band was really the one making all the money. And he would give us like 50 bucks to split and walk with the lion's share. So after our band broke up, I realized that you could actually get paid in New York City to drink alcohol for free, okay? This job was called a nightclub promoter. So you just had to get beautiful people in the clubs, and if you got the right people in the clubs, you could charge them like $18 for a vodka soda. You could charge guys $500 to buy a bottle of champagne that cost you $40. So the next 10 years of my life disappeared. There are actually chunks that I don't remember too well. This is me at 28 years old. And here you can see I think I'm on top of the world. So much so that I am holding out the Rolex watch so that the photographer notices that I own an expensive watch. It's pretty pathetic. was getting paid $2,000 a month to drink the bottle of Bacardi. I was getting paid $2,000 a month by Budweiser just to be seen in public drinking Bud. So I thought I was the man, you know, I thought I had arrived. I had a BMW, I had a grand piano in my apartment, I had a Labrador Retriever, and my girlfriend was on billboards. If you'd run into me around 5 in the morning, it looked a little less glamorous. Looks more like this. So as you can imagine, you know, you pick up a lot of vices in a decade in nightlife, whether that's recreational drug use, whether it's gambling or pornography or strip clubs. So I had them all at this point. Thankfully, on another New Year's trip to Punta del Este in Uruguay with all of the beautiful people, I realized I was the worst person I knew. I was in this beautiful place in Uruguay and servants and horses and, you know, we spent $1,000 on fireworks, Dom Perignon, magnums everywhere. And I realized, man, I am never gonna find what I'm looking for, where I'm looking for it. I realized I was spiritually bankrupt, I was emotionally bankrupt, I was certainly morally bankrupt. And hungover during the day, I started reading theology in the Bible again. And that was an interesting kind of contrast to my life. And, you know, I started looking for this very lost faith that I had as a kid that meant so much to me. But I remember hating some of the religious stuff that I grew up with. And I came across this verse that said, true religion is to look after widows and orphans in their distress and to keep yourself from being polluted. I thought, man, I'm 0 for 2. I mean, I haven't done anything for the poor in 10 years, and I literally pollute the world. I mean, I get people wasted for a living. So I came back to New York and said, man, I have to do something radically, radically different. I need to change everything about my life. So I left New York, I rented a cobalt blue Ford Mustang, I started driving aimlessly north. I wound up on Moosehead Lake in Maine from a dial-up internet cafe, and I made this kind of deal with God where I said, I'm gonna give back a year of the 10 years I wasted, and I wanna just serve. So I started applying to humanitarian organizations to volunteer. I thought, wouldn't it be cool if I could go to the poorest country in the world? So to my surprise, I am denied by every single humanitarian organization I applied to. So they're like, what do you do again? We're serious people. Thankfully, one organization says, if you pay us $500 a month, you can volunteer with us. So I said, here are my credit card details. Where are you guys going? They said, we're going to Liberia. I said, what's that? They said, it's a country in Africa. I thought Africa was a country. So I pay them the $500. I say, I'm gonna sign up and be your volunteer photojournalist. I'd always taken pretty good pictures and photos and love telling stories, albeit potentially the wrong ones. And everything in my life changed. I decided in one fell swoop to kind of never smoke again, to never touch drugs again, you know, to never gamble again, to, you know, to swear off pornography and strip clubs, and just, I needed to walk so far in the other direction. And I walked up this gangway, and this became my new home, a 522-foot yacht. It was a hospital ship. For 25 years, these amazing doctors had sailed up and down the African coast with a simple mission: bring doctors to the people who need access to medical care but can't afford it. So I was gonna be documenting everything these volunteers did, and 350 people living on the ship. I go from a nice apartment in New York to about 200 square feet on the ship with cockroaches and two roommates that worked in the engine room. Started feeling sorry for myself until I grabbed my camera and started seeing how people were living in Liberia, in apartment buildings like this or houses like this. No roofs, no windows. What I was actually gonna be photographing was facial deformity up close. We were facial surgeons as a specialty, so before the ship would come in, an advanced team would fly out of the country and say, if you've got a giant tumor on your face, flesh-eating disease, if your child was born with a cleft lip or a cleft palate, turn up on this day and maybe our doctors can help you. So I was so excited. It was my third day on the mission. I grabbed the camera, 5:30 in the morning, roll up to the soccer stadium where we're gonna be helping people. And I know that we have 1,500 surgery slots. And there are 7,000 people standing outside the stadium. I'll tell you, it was really tough, knowing that over 5,000 people were gonna be sent home. Some who had walked a month, it got tougher. The first kid in line was this boy named Alfred, and he was suffocating to death on his own face with a 4-pound tumor. Now, he lived in a country with one doctor for every 50,000 people that had been wrecked by a 14-year civil war. So when you got sick in this country, you just died. His mom showed me this photo. 4 years earlier, at 10, this is what Alfred looked like. Just a benign tumor started growing, no one to go to. Alfred at 14. So I remember just being terrified. I ran in the corner, I started crying. I was like, take me back to New York. I don't think I can handle this. And the chief medical officer came over to me and said, dude, you signed up for this job. Like, did you not look at our website? We've been doing this for 25 years. Do your job, and we're gonna be able to help Alfred. So I put it together enough to get through 2 days. I saw things so much worse than this, things I never thought were possible to happen to people. A couple days later, though, I learned why we were there, and I watched Alfred's surgery. And I watched these volunteer doctors operate on his face, take the tumor, set it down on a tray, and I watched him recover in the recovery room. And they said, Scott, why don't you take Alfred home so you can see what it's like when someone's received back into their family. And it was amazing. There was a huge party. There were hundreds of people welcoming Alfred, who had been written off for dead. This was what life was like. Wake up in the morning, go down to the ward, meet Martha Lean. Get to know her story. She's got this towel in her hand because people would throw rocks at her. They thought she was cursed. She needed a 40-minute surgery. She couldn't afford, and there was no place to do it in the country. So it was an intense year. I took 50,000 photos. I could probably do a day telling you all their stories. I signed up for a second tour, really not knowing what was next. And on the second tour, I started learning one of the things that was making people sick, and it was dirty water. And so thankfully for me, there was a guy off to the side of the medical operation that was given a little bit of money to work in the villages. And he was concerned about water. And he would take me into the rural villages, and he would show me what people were drinking. I just remember I couldn't believe it. And it was a beautiful pond until how a teenage girl walks out of the bush, starts filling up her bucket and drinking the water. I remember saying to him, like, dude, no wonder things are growing on people's faces. If this is the water they're drinking, if this is the water they're bathing. So what he would do is, he had very little resources, but he would work with the locals, and he would tap into the clean groundwater that was 40 feet beneath the village. I thought, what a horrible irony. People are living on top of clean water, dying without it. And he would take me back, and I could see these villages transformed through clean water. Now, while all the surgeries had obviously made a deep impact on me in 2 years, this guy off to the side was helping thousands of people. You know, I thought it was kind of maybe the question behind the question. If he didn't have water, how could he be healthy? So I came back to New York City. I was 30. You know, my friends were kind of looking to see what was next as he go back in the nightclubs. And what they got was me on the laptop showing him pictures of tumors and dirty water, saying, will you help? Some said yes. Some said, you're ruining my buzz. I'd seen all these problems while I was there, and you know, the lack of education, people dying of AIDS, people dying of malaria. I just could not get this image of a child in a swamp out of my mind. I just thought, I can't believe we live in a world where this happens. And that's where the idea for Charity Water was born. So I'm going to talk about water as I started exploring it and what I learned. So the water crisis, right? Here's the big stat, which is almost impossible for all of us to comprehend. 800 million people don't have clean water. Well, I don't know what 800 million of anything looks like, let alone people without water. So I wanted to put faces and names and really understand what it was like to live without access to clean water. I was born in Philadelphia. I never had to think about drinking dirty water. The water crisis for my friends was a $10 bottle of Pellegrino at the club. This is what it looks like out there. 15-year-olds named John Bosco, drinking from a swamp in the middle of his village. This is in northern Ethiopia, where the community is just sharing an open well with their cattle. Lots of diseases, as you can imagine, associated with bad water. Some you've heard of, like cholera. Some maybe you haven't, like schistosomiasis, which is just a fancy word for parasites or worms. About 300 million people right now have parasites in their body, crawling towards their liver. This child was a good example of that. She was drinking from a river in Athenai, Kenya, and every time she would drink, she would kind of spit up on her shirt. And we watched in horror, took the water from her, promised to try to help the village. But I really wanted to know what was in the river water that was making her throw up. So I took it back through customs, didn't really tell anyone, gave it to a lab, said, would you guys throw this under a microscope and make me a movie? And they did, and this is the movie they made. Now they said, we don't know how to break down all these different amoebas and parasites, but that water is definitely alive. No child should be drinking water like that. I learned that leeches were a huge problem throughout the developing world. Now, I'm pretty sure no one in this room has struggled with a leech in their drinking water recently. But if you got your water from an open spring like this, you would. And you would learn that the big ones are pretty easy to filter out. That's not the problem. It's the little leeches that get through the filtration and then like to grow up inside you, and their favorite spot is the back of the throat. Two ways to get a leech, if you live in a rural community, out of the back of your child's throat. One, you use a stick and you scrape it, or two, you give your kid a little bit of diesel fuel, just enough to kill the leech and hopefully not enough to injure your child. And this is how the filtration is done. Many communities don't have the awareness around boiling the water. Many actually can't afford to buy the charcoal to boil the water. I learned that schools around the world didn't have clean water. Now, if there was a second issue I would go after, it was probably education. I learned that about half of the world's schools did not have clean water or toilets. So how could kids get a good education if they had to wake up in the middle of the night, early morning, and bring river water with them to school? And when the girls got their period, well, they stayed home a few days because they were ashamed to go to a school with no water and no toilets. A lot of them would drop out and spend their time walking for water with 40 pounds on their back. Hard to imagine. You guys, you know, I just saw Brian before. He's like, yeah, it's really heavy. That's like 1/400th of the walk that millions are doing every single day. It is heavy. I was in Malawi a couple weeks ago, and I just keep seeing stuff that I think is too good, like it's a story. Turn up in a village and we'd actually help that village get clean water. The place was called Cicada. And these villagers come from Cicada across this river and they say, well, we know that this village has clean water and we want to convince you and your local partners to bring the rig to us. So they started filling in a ravine because they cared about the water so badly. And we're like, yes, we will absolutely try to bring the rig to you. He said, where are you drinking water now? And then they showed us their source. And we saw pigs running around. Where's the dignity in that? A little farther down, the Shira River runs through Malawi. It's a beautiful river, unless you drink from it. If you do, your biggest problem is crocodiles. Again, this sounds crazy, until you hear the stories, until you actually see the scars. This community told us that a child had died in the last year in the community. And they built a little early warning system there. You can kind of see with the sticks. To the left of this photo, there was a pile of rocks to throw at the crocodiles. Farther down the Shear River, I met this guy, Smith. He said he lost his brother to a crocodile on this spot. After that, he donated his dugout canoe so the women could feel a little safer standing in it as they got the water. A guy actually in this village was in the hospital that day from a crocodile attack. Of all the stories, there's one that struck me the most. I've been to Ethiopia 17 times now. It's a country I'm deeply passionate about. And on a trip last year, I learned about this woman named Leda Kouros. I actually never met her, and this is a picture of a woman about her age in the same region. She lived 10 years ago. I was at a crappy $6 a night hotel room, and the hotel owner comes up to us and says, you're the Charity Water people. Yeah, we know what you've been doing here. We know what your partners have been doing. Let me tell you a story about this woman that lived in my village when I was young. And he starts telling me this woman's story. He said she used to walk, believe it or not, 8 hours a day. 3 hours out, 5 hours back. And she didn't have the yellow jerry can. She had this clay pot, which weighs 10 or 15 pounds just empty. Then you put another 30 pounds of water in it. The water had dried up, you know, she can't move because it's the only land that she owns, and she lives off the land, so she walks 8 hours. He said one day, she comes back into the village after her walk, she slips and she falls, the clay pot breaks, and all the water spills out. And he said she took the rope and she hung herself from the village, from a tree in the middle of the village. And he let that sit there, and then he said, the work you guys are doing is important, and he walked off. It was a great reminder that this is not about 800 million people as a statistic. This is about people, because of where they are born, who have no hope. So, it's gonna get happier. It's a solvable problem, right? And if you don't try and take one solution, one silver bullet, and jam it down the world's throat, there are lots of ways to bring clean water to people around the world. Sometimes it's a hand-dug well, like in Liberia. Sometimes it's a drilled well. Sometimes rainwater harvesting or spring catchments or pond sand filters or biosand filters. At its cheapest, it looks like this, a $65 filter. It's the program in Cambodia. There's actually a lot of arsenic in the groundwater. But you can take surface water and you can clean it. The entire community gets together, they're educated. They agree to contribute $5 per family. And then actually contribute the labor. And this thing can take water like this and turn it into water like this that you or I could drink. In fact, I did. It's fine. For about $6,000, you can hand dig a well, and that's what they were doing in Liberia. And people ask me all the time, how come they just don't dig their own wells? Well, this is the moment where you need some help. You see, the water is actually coming in here. You don't want to stop there, and if you keep going, it just turns into soup. You need a dewatering pump and a generator so that you can go about another 20 or 30 feet beneath this. So when the water table drops in the dry season, the well does not go dry. Communities are more than willing to contribute the labor, the sand, the gravel. Concrete culverts are made, and this keeps the well from collapsing over time. For about $10,000, you can drill a well, and that's a lot of fun. You bring in a million-dollar drilling rig, 8 skilled drillers. And now you're tapping into lakes, underground rivers, and you get massive amounts of water. This well yielded 6 liters per second. It was enough for the 1,000 people at the school and the entire community. In India, the campaign you've been hearing about in this conference, it's about $20,000 to wire a whole village, to hook up a village. It's typically a mountain spring that's high up and lots of pipe, but instead of bringing it into the center of the village, you actually bring it to every household. A huge water tower is made, and then gravity brings it down to toilets and showers and taps in the home so that a woman can walk to the back of her home, shower, bathe, and have clean water at her home. We really believe that when you can bring water into a community, it's transformative. We say it changes everything. It obviously makes people healthier. If you're not drinking water with leeches and parasites, you're healthier. Diarrhea rates go down. Gives kids more time to spend in school if they are not walking hours every morning. If they're not sick with diarrhea, with parasites. It gives women time back in their day. And unfortunately, throughout the developing world, it is the job of women and children to get the water. And the women will tell us, you know, we've started a small business with this extra time. We're selling rice at the market. We're selling peanuts at the market, earning an extra 50 cents or a dollar a day. Some women just say we're better moms, spend more time with our kids. And what I loved about this issue, and what I hope compels you, is it's just kind of so simple. No one here believes that that child should be drinking the water on the left. No one. If you do, you're kind of crazy. And we know how to help. And it's measurable, and it's provable. You can know that water is clean. You can test it. A lot of health benefits. We also started learning that water makes people wealthier. There's an 88-page report published by the UN last year saying, for every dollar you invest in water and sanitation, you get an $8 to $12 economic return. Imagine that. $1 million investment makes a community $8 to $12 million richer. They found in some rural communities it was as high as 22 times return. Time savings, improved health, improved education, the ability to work. It's kind of common sense. Community involvement is obviously key. What happens after the project is built and training locals, giving them the capacity, secretaries and village sanitation workers and caretakers. This guy wouldn't let us take his photo until he went and got his book. In his book, he's recording the money he collects from every user of the water point. And that goes into the maintenance account. And that account is managed by everyone here. I'll tell you probably my favorite story around water. We were in northern Uganda. Our team was visiting a village that actually had clean water. And it was the end of a day. And let me tell you, when you go into these villages, there's a party. There's a celebration. People throw popcorn and dance and sing. And sometimes it goes on for hours. So Becky, our water program director, was just trying to kind of sneak in and see, you know, how the community was doing, how the water point was functioning. Helen Appio gets wind of this visit and shuts that idea right down.
And the road.
So Becky sits down with her, and I'm going to read you guys something that lasts for a little bit. She says, Helen, tell me your story. I'll read you what she wrote. Before she had clean water, Helen would wake up before dawn. She would take her only 2 5-gallon jerry cans, and she would walk almost a mile and a half to the nearest water point. Because there simply wasn't enough water, she would wait in line with hundreds of other women. Helen spent most of her day walking and waiting. Every day she'd say to herself, how should I use this water today? Should I water my garden so we can grow food? Should I wash my children's uniforms? Should I use it to cook a meal? Should we drink this water? With 2 children, 1 husband, and 10 gallons, Helen had to make choices. I saw the shame in her eyes when she described how she would return from her long trek to find her 2 young children waiting for her. They were often sent home from school because their uniforms were dirty. Helen just never had enough water. But now, life was different for Helen. I am happy now, Helen beamed. I have time to eat, my children can go to school, and I can even work in my garden, take a shower, and come back for more water if I want. I am bathing so well. A few of the men chuckled to hear a woman talk about bathing. But all I noticed was Helen's glowing face, the fresh flowers in her hair, and the lovely green dress she wore for special occasions. Touching her forearm, I replied, well, you look great. Yes, she paused. Placing both hands on my shoulders and smiling, she said this. She said, now I am beautiful. And of course she was. We thought, what an amazing thing. What a crazy thing to be able to restore someone's dignity and make them feel beautiful just by tripling the quantity of water. Okay, charity water. So we started 7 years ago. This was the couch, so it was a startup story. I was completely broke after 2 years giving Mercy Ships $500 a month. Nightclub promoters are awesome at saving money, we are awesome at spending money, and we are terrible at saving money. So I was $30,000 in debt at the time. A friend says you can start your charity on my couch and you can live in the spare bedroom. And I took him up on it. And I was so, so passionate. I was running around with my laptop, showing people pictures, and telling everybody that I wanted to end the water crisis in my lifetime. Looking at them like, you know, I meant this. And they look at me like I was crazy. But I said, you know, I want to create a world where someday my kids and my grandkids, you know, don't have to ever hear about kids dying of dirty water or drinking water with leeches in it. At the same time, I had some thoughts about giving and charity. And I thought, I really want to reinvent giving. Let me speak to this a little bit. So I come back, I'm 30, I'm trying to get all my friends involved, and I learned that they are distrustful of charities. They say charities are just big black holes. That was kind of the common theme. You know, I give my money, I don't know where it goes, I don't know how much actually reaches the people. Everybody seemed to have a horror story in their back pocket of some CEO making millions. You know, someone who had embezzled funds to go buy Lexuses. Well, I was not jaded, right? I was fired up about getting people help. My friends are spending $500 on bottles of champagne. They shouldn't be allowed to have excuses on why not to be generous. So I had three ideas that I thought could bring some of them back to the table. One, what if I could create a financial model where we just put that entire black hole thing off to the side? And we could say every time 100% of your money will go directly to the field. Every time. And people said, you know, well, dude, that's crazy. Like, how will you actually pay, like, a staff and you're gonna need an office? Like, how will you even fly around to know what's going on? I didn't really know at the time, but I opened up two bank accounts with $100 each. Said maybe we could get board members and sponsors and private donors and maybe companies and foundations to actually get excited about paying for those costs. I made this promise, though, that the public's money would never be touched. In fact, we would pay back credit card fees. So if someone gave, you know, $100 and American Express took $4 off the top, we would actually raise the 4% separately and send all 100 bucks to the field. Got a lot of your crazy looks, but that was idea number one. The second was, well, now we're not gonna step on the money, so let's just prove it. Let's show people exactly where it goes, and let's use technology to do that. Now, you know, I'm no great technologist, but I walked into a Best Buy at the time, and I saw that handheld GPS devices were 99 bucks. I'm like, with $100 and two AA batteries, we can turn this thing on and know where our projects are everywhere in the world. I said, great, so let's never fund a water project anywhere unless we prove it publicly on Google Maps and Google Earth. And then the third thing was I really wanted to build a brand and look at this as building an epic brand. There weren't any charity brands that I really aspired to. Yeah, there were some big and safe charities that had been around for a long time, but there was no Nike, there was no Apple. Nick Kristof had written in the New York Times, people peddle toothpaste with more sophistication than all the world's life-saving causes. I thought, man, how broken is that? How sad, how true. Charities were some of the worst marketers and storytellers, and I didn't think you needed a lot of money to build a brand, you just needed taste, a couple talented people. Probably the most important idea, though, was instead of us flying around, opening up offices around the world, was working through local partners. As I had traveled, I had seen amazing indigenous groups leading their own people forward who didn't have any skill at fundraising, at marketing, at raising awareness. And there was capacity lying everywhere. Someone could do 100 water projects a year and they had the money for 11. So he said, this will be the model. Work through the locals, and we'll take this piece of storytelling and shining the light on them and their amazing work and trying just to get people to care. So it started with a party. It's the only thing I knew how to do. I was a nightclub promoter. So I got someone to donate a club. I threw my 31st birthday party. I got 700 people to come out. I lured them with open bar. And I charged them 20 bucks at the door. And this time, instead of pocketing the $15,000, we took it immediately to a refugee camp in northern Uganda called Bobi, where 31,638 people were living. We built three wells, we fixed three wells, and then we sent the photos and the GPS and the story back to those 700 people. This was a big deal. Some people didn't even remember the party. They thought it was awesome that they'd come, they'd been generous, but seriously, I mean, people could not believe that a charity would bother to report to them on a $20 gift and that something actually happened with the money that they could see, that they could connect with. And we said, let's just keep doing this. Let's keep closing the loop until the problem is solved. We would always have a marketing budget of effectively zero, and I thought, well, let's try and come up with fun, creative. Maybe we could get donated media. Maybe we don't always need to take ourselves so seriously all the time. Most of the time we did. You know, we were always trying to bring statistics to life, right? Again, 800 million people. How about 4,500 kids dying? Their parents throughout this room. Can you imagine 4,500 kids doing anything? Maybe if you had to give your kid death in a baby bottle. from a river. I mean, we can get people to care. We wound up getting tons of donated media on buses and taxis, full-page ads in magazines, TV spots. This was a pet project of mine. I wanted to shoot rich people in the same situations as the people we were seeing around the world and trying to serve. Right? What if it was your mom or your grandma drinking that water? Your kids going to a prep school? Sent my banker friends up to Central Park Pond during their lunch break. We would never allow this. Why was it okay for other people's kids, other people's moms, because of where they were born? We tried to creatively partner with companies. This was one of my favorite. We sat around and we're like, you know, we sell these like $5,000 wells, and Saks Fifth Avenue sells $5,000 purses, which is crazy and awesome for them. What if we did something? We're both in New York. So we pitched them this idea. We said, you know, will you help us tell our story? And instead of being thrown out, they said, we love this idea. We would love to spread this idea to our customers, to our vendors, and to our customers. They wound up shooting their catalogs in water for 2 seasons. They wound up giving us the windows on Fifth Avenue and in windows all across the country to raise awareness. And they raised $700,000 as a company. Brought clean water to 140 communities. McAllen. So listen to this one. McAllen comes to us afterwards and they say, there's a lot of water in the making of whiskey and there's a lot of water in Scotland. We're like, and? they think about it, they come back to us and they say, we found a 64-year-old McAllen. It is our most prized possession. What if we put it in a beautiful decanter and we took it on a world tour, and if people wanted to taste it, they had to donate $5,000. And we're like, yeah, right. Who's gonna drop $5,000 to like taste your whiskey? $605,000. It broke the Guinness World Record 4 times over. We love social media, and you know, this is a room full of people proficient in this. You know, we were the first charity to get 1 million followers on Twitter and still the most followed charity in the world. We were one of the first few brands to use Instagram, not only the first charity. I mean, anything came out, we wanted to just start trying to tell our story through the platform and see if it stuck. And try to engage our supporters in really interesting and creative ways all around the world. We tried to reinvent the gala. You guys have all been invited to these, you know, rubber chicken kind of round table bad dinners, and the chicken's cold and there's a bad PowerPoint. And we said, let's make this fun. Like, we're helping people around the world get clean water. So we turned it into a party, and we invited 2,500 people every year in New York, and we made it only $250 to attend, so it wasn't like 10 grand a ticket. And we created experiences. This is where the water walk was birthed. We said, why don't you just walk just for a second in someone else's shoes? And then give meaning to that walk as businesses could sponsor and make a contribution every time someone walked. This was the big idea though, and we completely stumbled into it on our 1 year anniversary. So we were gonna go back into the club just as a creature of habit. You know, I guess I was gonna throw a bigger birthday party, get a bigger club, charge a little more at the door. I thought, man, I'm just too old for this. And it doesn't really scale. So I got this idea, what if I could give up my birthday and ask everyone I knew for $32, my age in dollars. I said, you know, I certainly don't need an Amazon gift card. I don't need a tie. I don't need shoes or, you know, the crap that people normally get you. People don't even have clean water. Everyone I knew could donate $32. So I just started an email war, emailed everyone I knew, and I wound up raising $59,000. I said, wow, you know, I promised my friends I would drill a well live via satellite. I did, connected them to it. But I said, you know, most people have everything they need here and they don't really need more birthday gifts. You know, everybody could do this. So I started just, you know, trying out this idea. This 7-year-old kid in Austin, Texas starts going door to door asking for $7 and he raises 22 grand. You know? Mr. Bieber tweeted 3 times, raised $47,000, beating out Joe Biden and Adam Lambert. I'd never heard of this guy. Set a $29,000 goal. He raised $320,000. Started spreading into sports, into fashion, into tech. Jack now has done 3 birthdays, raised almost $200,000. Will and Jada Smith gave up their birthdays and then asked their fans to give up birthdays. And then we invited him to come with us and actually meet some of the people and drill and see what they'd done. So that was all cool, but you know what? Most of the money was actually raised by people you've never heard of. Kids like Lori, who's a little bit of a punk. Maggie Moran, you know, giving up her 16th birthday. Nona Ween, giving up her 89th birthday. Guys, appreciate this. Read her mission statement. She gets it. She is more than double the life expectancy in many of these countries where we work. Some people said, I can't wait until my birthday. I just need to fundraise now. I need to do something about this now. And it started quickly going beyond birthdays. People would climb mountains, try and raise a dollar a foot, blowing through goals. People started skydiving for charity water. These guys turned up in our office a couple weeks ago. Like, hi, we biked from California. Serious. People gave up wedding gifts, gave up anniversaries, gave up honeymoons. People started sailing across the Atlantic Ocean. 4 or 5 people now walked across America, which takes 4 months, you know, in solidarity of the millions walking around the world every single day. Riley ate rice and beans for a month, raised $15,000. We made a short video.
1 billion people do not have clean water. The water not good for the kids, it's so dangerous.
I was eating rice and beans for 25 days to raise money for my first well.
Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Let's go. Is the cat put out? Is the iron off? We don't want to come home to a fire. Have you trimmed your beard? Are your sandals shine? Do you look like a hipster messiah? Have you got your keys? Have you got ID? Did you bring a comb for Gary? Have you had a think and a warm up drink? Now, 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 now.
Take 156. This is my second time shooting for charity water.
Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Let's go. Leave your book and leave the mirror, 'cause you're already stunning. The sky above was never clearer, and the engine's running. Well, the end is nigh, and there's not much time, so get things rolling. Life is pain, but we're okay. Now, 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 now. What have I forgotten?
The whole.
So our fundraisers were amazing, right? They were bringing the best. Thank you, guys. They were bringing the best of themselves, creativity, passion, stuff we had never thought of. There was a guy recently writing haikus in Afghanistan for clean water. I didn't even remember what a haiku was. I had to Google it. Most of these stories were happy. They were inspiring. I can't talk about our fundraisers without telling you one story which is certainly inspiring, but also tragic. It's a girl named Rachel Beckwith, who you see here, and she saw me speak. She'd belonged to a kind of big young church in Seattle that had raised $1 million through throwing a keg party. It's a whole nother story. And I went there to thank them for being awesome and not too religious and raising $1 million, and she was in the audience, and I asked people to give up their birthday. And she gives up her 9th birthday. She sets a goal of raising $300. She raises $220, falls a little short, and she tells her mom that she's sorry and she's gonna try to do better next year because she really wanted 15 people to get clean water. I was in the Central African Republic. I landed with my wife and walked in my door, and I got a text that Rachel had been killed in a horrible car crash right after her birthday. It was a 20-car pileup. She was the only fatality. Her mom was driving with her sister in the front, and a tractor trailer came into the back seat of her car. The family asked us, you know, could you please reopen Rachel's campaign so we can honor her last wish, which was to give kids clean water instead of accepting birthday gifts or a present. So we do, and this young pastor rallies his church and says everybody needs to donate $9. Campaign goes up to $100,000. The Seattle community gets a hold of this, takes a campaign up to $300,000, 1,000 times more than her dream. And then it just starts spreading around the world. Kids in Africa start donating. Hearing about this 9-year-old girl that cared for people she'd never met. So I met her mom soon after. Her mom wanted to do some of the talk shows and just kind of talk about who her daughter was as a person and talk about this dream for others. I remember meeting Samantha and just blurting out, you need to come with me and spend the 1-year anniversary of Rachel's death in Africa meeting some of the people that she'd helped. And she started crying and I started crying and she said, I'd love to come. Can I bring my pastor? Can I bring my parents, Rachel's grandparents? So that trip happened and we wanted to just capture it in a way of honoring the family and honoring Rachel's amazing, amazing dream and legacy. And I want to share that video with you guys.
And we're about to go see some of Rachel's wells.
I am Richard. I am Rachel's grandfather. I really wish Rachel could be here today. Because first of all, Rachel would think that this is probably the neatest thing she'd ever seen in her entire life.
Community, our church, where we are from, we greatly love Rachel and continue to love her family. And I'm overwhelmed with how greatly you have honored her memory. So please receive my most deepest and heartfelt thanks. You've done us a great honor today, so thank you. Yep.
Rachel developed such a big heart from such a young age that she understood and felt the pain of others on the other side of the world. To give up her birthday present so that other children can improve their lives is the most beautiful gift a person can give.
So Rachel, as you can imagine, you know, inspired the heck out of everyone at Charity Water, and was really, I remember, it was one of the most incredible experiences to be there. The Ethiopian community had honored her so greatly. They had named a park after her. They'd named a valley after her. Their children were presenting Samantha with pictures that they'd drawn for Rachel. You kind of saw that scene in like an old church. The priest had gotten there at midnight to welcome us at 8, kind of just showing their reverence and their sympathy. What it really helped illustrate at Charity Water was what had started out 7 years ago as our story, this scrappy, disruptive startup, and we're gonna break a lot of the rules. It didn't belong to us. This was their story. This was the story of our supporters all around the world. This was the story of Max. It was a story of Lori and Maggie and Nona and Rachel. It was a story of our beneficiaries, people like Ledecoros, people like Helen. And if we could actually be intentional and get out of the way and build a platform and just give people the tools to bring the best of themselves, their generosity, their compassion, their creativity, maybe we could make an impact that's never been seen before in this world. So we started to focus on stewardship and on connecting people to their impact. And we created something called Dollars to Projects because we wanted Maggie to see where her money went. And when her $5,709 was spent, she could see that $4,596 went to the community of Mywell. She could see pictures. She could see how many people lived in the village. She could see her name on a sign or a plaque just to make it real. She could see where it was in the world. And every donor, even if they gave a dollar or $16, could see exactly where 100% of their money went. We needed to go faster in some countries, so we started crowdsourcing drilling rigs. And we said, well, how do we connect thousands of people that funded a rig to this, you know, inanimate object that's gonna drill for the next 15 years? So we mounted GPS units on these things, and we built tracking tools. We even gave them Twitter accounts, so they tweet every single time they drill, so people could just feel connected, thousands of miles away. Really excited, last year we announced we were the recipient of a $5 million award from Google to work on a new remote sensor that we could put in these water projects that would let us know how much water is flowing over time. And at the same time, continue funding local mechanics, local repair businesses, local entrepreneurs to keep water flowing. This is one of the pilots in Ethiopia. We have about 7 labs working on this at the moment. So in 2 weeks, we're gonna turn 7. We've now raised $100 million from about 500,000 supporters, but this is not about the money. This has been about getting people involved in what we can do with it. And that's been to help over 3.3 million people get access to clean water in 20 different countries and in about 8,600 villages. And the exciting thing for me is as our small team works in New York, right now there are over 1,000 people working around the world. Locals leading their own communities forward. Last year we gave one person clean water every 44 seconds. I told my team, I'm like, you guys slept 8 hours, if you got 8 hours of sleep, and 600 people that you will never meet got clean water because you've poured your talent and your passions and your time into this organization. This year, we're hoping to serve 1 million people in a year alone. And I'm so interested in taking back these statistics. I mean, instead of talking about 4,500 kids dying every day, we talk about 2,000 people getting clean water every day. So here's where we're going. As we look ahead, we realize, 3 million out of 800 million, while 3 million people may fill up stadiums and we can make ourselves feel good, we had a long ways to go. And we have put a stake in the ground here at 100 million people. We said we'd like to do this in the decade. Now, this is kind of impossible. I mean, it's growth that no charity in the world has ever experienced. It's going to be at least a $30 billion, a $3 billion problem with $30 a person. And we're going to have to keep raising money to keep this 100% model intact. Right now, that's done through about 100 donors. So we realize people will tell us this can't be done, but we think, man, if there's ever a time in the world when this is possible, it's certainly today. I mean, it's today more than a month ago or a year ago or 10 years ago in this connected world where people are really looking to give. They're looking to make an impact. So I was thinking about this last night, how do I end? And, it's easy just to kind of say thank you and end, and I'm actually pretty shy. But I thought, this would be a waste if I didn't actually make an ask, if I didn't ask you guys to get involved and ask you to join us and ask for your help. We just launched this campaign, the September campaign. You saw Joe Madiath and his amazing work. I thought, I'm not really asking for me, I'm asking for him. I'm asking for this guy who was on the ground for 34 years, that after he saw his grandfather feed a human like a dog, he said, that's not okay, and has dedicated 34 years to righting that injustice through clean water and dignity and sanitation. I'm asking on behalf of this village right now, Patapali Village, 352 people, and the kids there. They have started working in 2011, building toilets and showers and trenches for pipe in faith, in the hope that the money will come and Joe and his team can actually bring clean water to the village. Rama lives there, and I started a campaign because I don't want her to bathe in that water. It's crazy. I don't want her to take that water home and cook with it. So we launched the campaign here with you guys. The goal is to raise $2 million and help 100 villages. HubSpot has already taken the first three. Now, we know to raise $2 million, we need 2,000 fundraising campaigns. And we've got 250 already. The average campaign raises $1,000. We've seen this over 5 years. So my ask today of you guys is, there are enough people in this room to knock that out. I think about 3,000 people in this room. We could do this. We could actually solve the entire September campaign through this conference, through the last day of this conference, and help 100 villages get clean water. That's my challenge to you guys. I would love to ask the HubSpot employees to stand up, because you guys have done this already. And you are all a part of this campaign. Thank you, guys. So this takes a lot of guts. This takes a lot of guts. But if you would be willing to start a fundraising campaign for India, would you stand up and help Joe and his team? That's amazing, guys. So, it's pretty much done. There are enough of you. Seriously, I mean this. Like, we can do this together. I started my campaign, and that would be the most amazing thing. It's never been done before at a conference. If you guys follow through, you can go to charitywater.india I'll tell you what, we're at 250 campaigns. If we get to 2,000 in the next 24 hours, I'll donate $2,000 myself. And I live in a one-bedroom apartment and I don't have a car, so I am not rich. Thank you guys so much for your time and your generosity.
So it's the third time I've heard that speech, and I still, my bladder's close to my eyes. I first came across Scott. It's an interesting story how I came across him. I had a speaking gig at the Inc. 500 conference this year, which I was backstage. Scott spoke before me. I didn't meet him, but I was waiting backstage and listening to him. And as I was listening to him, I thought, oh, this is a great man on a great mission who also happens to be a great marketer. And it was backstage this last October, I said, I've got to figure out a way to get to know this guy, expose him to the HubSpotters, expose him to the whole InBound crew. He's such a good example of a marketer, and I think we can help him out. And I had the positive thought was, how do I expose him to all of you? The really negative thought I had in my head was, oh crap, I have to speak after this guy. He is fantastic. So if you guys could help, that'd be great. I'm gonna give my birthday up this year, so please help out. Charity Wire is just awesome.
Just another round of applause for Brian and Scott as well. That was... And for all of you, for everyone here who's starting a campaign, please. I know it's weird to clap for yourself, but just do it. Okay, well, it's really been a pleasure having you all here. I can't thank you all enough on behalf of HubSpot for joining us. And I think we're gonna do this again next year. I think I mentioned this already. So next year again, September 15th through 18th at the BCEC, so a little bigger spot. Again, there is a feedback survey, as I mentioned, on www.inbound.com/feedback. If you fill that out, you can actually get the lowest rate we'll be offering for Inbound next year. So fill that out, give us your feedback. And once again, on behalf of HubSpot, thank you all for joining us very much. Good night.